If I had to describe all games' graphics in one word, it would be flat. Nowadays, when you want something to have texture, you need to create a material with all sorts of physical parameters, like roughness, metallicness, normal, etc. Of course, you can just leave these values empty and use the default settings, but that doesn't mean the engine still won't use these values to render your texture. If we play an old game like Half-Life, we can see that all the textures are very uniformly lit. All the detail is conveyed through the texture itself. We cannot see how shiny something is. We can only see what it looks like and take a guess. This is especially visible when you try to render old games using modern rendering techniques. Everything ends up looking very plastic-like, as that's how materials with default values look like in modern engines. Now, of course, there are ways to minimize surface effects on the material, leaving us with a matte, flat texture akin to old rendering engines. But is that the right way to do it? And I'm not saying it's a bad thing to use period-appropriate rendering techniques for games which are aiming to recreate the retro look, but it is the style of choice for just about every retro game in existence, when I don't think it has to be. One thing we often hear about old games is that we remember them looking better. And that's in part because our standards were much lower back then. When I saw Heavy Rain on PlayStation 3 for the first time, I thought to myself, this is basically a movie. Game graphics just peaked. It's not getting any better than this. But now it doesn't look any better than an average PS4 game. In fact, most retro games break limitations of the time period and kinda just do their own thing. Ultra Kill is a great example. Not only it breaks rules of polygon limits and texture sizes, but it also uses a load of dynamic lights, which wouldn't be possible back on PlayStation 1. Bolt Gun, in a similar vein, uses much higher sprite resolution than what Duke Nukem or other games of that era would use, on top of using very modern lighting engines. There are very few games that actually stick to the limitations of the era they're trying to imitate. Have you ever seen a retro pixel art game that claims to look like games on the NES? Well, they most probably didn't, because NES and SNES period games would be displayed on a CRT TV, which would mute the colors and blur the pixels together. And that's fine. If we wanted the game to look absolutely faithful to the era, we would be making them on PlayStation 1 dev kits, not modern engines. Being able to pick what worked and discard what didn't is the difference between retro art style and actually dated graphics. As we are right now, retro look is basically what we can convince the players to be retro, without many actual rules or limitations. And yet, modern material properties are still pretty taboo in retro games community. I want to make a case that modern materials are not only very easy to add to your game, but they also enhance the experience. As I said, we often remember old games looking much better than they actually did, not only due to nostalgia, but also due to lower expectations and weaker hardware. Just adding material properties to an old game can transform its look into what we actually saw in our minds playing these games so long ago, and I have a perfect example of that. Look at this catwalk material. It's just a sheet of metal with holes cut into it. It's also pretty rusty, which adds some variety to how shiny it is. And the holes will have supple highlights based on where the light is coming from. Now look at the same material without any material properties. The whole thing is flat, has no sense of depth. We can't tell whether the surface is supposed to be shiny or not. Normal maps, roughness and metallics provide the context behind what a surface is and can be detrimental to conveying certain elements. In fact, Half-Life also tried to provide some basic surface properties with their chrome attribute given to certain textures, like Barney's helmet, Vortigon's colors, or Gordon's crowbar. Even though due to limitations, the chrome could not have any actual color texture on itself. Now, I expect to get some pushback on this choice. As I mentioned, retro look is just what people expect things to look, not actually how things looked in the past. And I expect some people to not like the idea of material properties just on the principle of it not being what they're accustomed to, or maybe they just find it ugly, I've seen those opinions too. Nonetheless, I am confident that the stylistic mix of PSX-like graphics with all the wonders of modern rendering techniques will result in an art style that keeps to its roots, while also providing much interactability and depth to the game's world.